thank you for this afternoon, Lord. I pray that we would just be able to focus our attention on you, that we would be able to learn from Stephen, and that we wouldn't be very distracted. It's in your son Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen.
So today is Angelology. Anybody want to do it?
Yes. We don't really know much about angels.
Well, that's I was going to say these come from Greek words.
Angel.
Angelos, this means angel.
Words.
Logos, this means word. Words about angels. We can talk a little bit more about the words for angels. But. So, as you did already rightly summarize, if you haven't heard me say it before, basically the one main thing that I learned from my angelology class in my undergrad was we don't know much about angels. There we go. Everything we do know is I don't say everything. A lot of what we claim to know is good guesses based on big texts. So that's as a preface to the way we're going to organize it. And actually, I think the outline on here is wrong. I changed it a little bit. But we will look at the basic definition, creation, nature, and then facts. So the facts section is, these are things where I can confidently claim this is something that, yes, the Bible clearly teaches this about angels. And then perceived actions is the next section. And that's where it's like, these are things that we see angels doing. Does that necessarily mean this is how they always act, or this is what they always do, etc.? The difference between prescriptive and descriptive text, we've talked about that before in here. Right? Prescriptive text telling you to do something, it's saying something is this way and you have to do it this way, versus descriptive is telling a story. It's saying that this thing happened, and so you draw the application yourself. Lots of the things with angels are descriptive texts. It's saying, an angel showed up and did this. Okay, so we as the interpreter then go, okay, does that mean that angels always do that? Or does that mean it happened this way that once and it changed or whatnot? Etc.
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 Trying to escape? Are you trying to escape?
Feel free to jump in with questions when we get to various topics of, okay, so what about, I heard that Satan was the music minister in heaven. Where does that come from? We'll look at the passage where that supposedly comes from. It doesn't actually teach that. So
he was spoiler a worship leader, huh?
Yeah.
That's where you get it from.
Sweet goodness.
Wait, you're with Anna Clayton? Salmon? Clayton? Satan?
What?
That was really intricate. Was that like off the top of your head?
No. So one time we were like, this is the rule for big families because we were talking about payments for a camp. And I was like, oh. And there's like, we should combine the names. And I was like, the Satan rule. And I was like, no, we can't call it that. And no, we that's can't just something I've always remember.
And reminded me.
He's always kept in the back of his mind. Ready to say.
Yeah. Waiting for the right moment.
I'm really impressed for a second.
just a second.
Earbuds hanging down.
Thank
you. I know who you are.
All right, introductory matters with angels. First of all, definition. I say definition. I didn't really put a definition. I just put the words for angels. But I kind of put a definition. Angel, heavenly messenger. That's what an angel is, messenger. And in both the Greek and the Hebrew text, the word for angel means either angel, like we think of it, like heavenly creature created by God, separate from humans, sort of a thing, or it just means messenger. So if somebody comes up and they are an angelos, if Paul sent an angelos, a messenger, to Peter, that doesn't necessarily mean that he's one of those heavenly beings with six wings and all that. It just means a messenger. Context determines which of those meanings is in play. If the guy shows up and he's shining and wearing white clothes and then he disappears, probably the heavenly messenger variety versus earthly messenger.
So context is the only way to know which one is...
Yeah, when that word is being used, which one is in view. Context will tell you. And usually it's pretty obvious. Usually the writer will give you other clues.
Well, usually God sent the messenger.
Yeah. They'll show up and they'll either be like so afraid of this messenger. It's like, well, okay. Maybe we're talking about something other than just another human with a message. But Angelos and Malach, if you know the word Malachi.
Nice.
This is I'm learning Hebrew so well now. The I ending is the first person possessive, so it's my, right? Messenger of me, my messenger. That's what the word Malachi means. That's what the name means. So the prophet Malachi, name means my messenger.
Kind of an off-topic question.
No problem.
But, like, how all of these prophets have names that mean, like, messenger of God or my messenger, these weren't their names from since their birth, were they?
Lots of them were.
Really?
Just in Hebrew culture, all names came from other meanings, had some definitional meaning. Same with Stephen, means crowned one.
It's
what? Just,
it's a sign.
It's from a Greek word, Stephanos, which means crown, right? It's just that since the words are in the same language as the root meaning of those words, they were linked. But most people had some sort of a name that
like
that had some sort of
name.
Majestic, yeah.
Wait, what was your question about? You said it didn't mean that when they first gave them their names.
So yeah, I don't know what the roots are for Cameron. Most names have some sort of a meaning.
Was that his name Malachi, and he grew up that name, and then he became
Irish or Scottish?
Oh, like
if
there was
a
correlation
that Malachi is my messenger, so we're kind of call him. We're gonna say with that name. Okay.
Well, and there is debate of some of these prophets, if they're actually, that was their actual name that they went by, like say, hey, Malachi, or if this was some, like, pen name that they gave themselves when they were writing their prophecies. That conversation goes on.
And was that normal back then?
Yeah.
But I feel like, now is, like, our names now, like, last names or something, is based off of, like, what our ancestors used to do, like, Smith is a common one, like, blacksmith
quite,
or whatever, right?
Quite often, yeah.
So it's like that what you're kind of thinking of, like...
No, not really like that, but, like, I sort of like it. More like it changed once he became a prophet. Like, he changed.
And that's the other thing, people in the Bible change their names more often than we do, right? Jacob to Israel, Naomi to Mara, right? The story of Ruth, you know that one? God will, Abram to Abraham, Sarah to Sarai, Sarai to Sarah. When God commissions someone to do something, he changes their name. He puts his mark on them. All four of the guys in Daniel, right?
Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego.
Those are all Babylonian names that Nebuchadnezzar gave them. Their actual names are Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. And those are all theophoric. Theophoric means relating to God, right? Theos, God. Relating back to, so they're names that have something to do with the Hebrew God. Daniel, El, is one of Elohim. You know that name for God, El, Daniel, and I think it's my servant is Daniel. Hananiah, anytime you hear that Yah ending, Yonah or Joshua, the Yah ending is short for Yahweh, right? That's
right.
Reference to the Hebrew God.
Even though
Yeshua.
Point, they wouldn't say Yahweh, so they would put it in name.
Yeah, well, it's a shortened, right? Just
but
the Yah part. It's like it's like an arrow. Like, that Yah thing is that points back to our God. Good little tangent. Yes, names mean things. Purpose or role of angels. Notice I put question mark after this. Convey messages from God to humans. The reason that I put this as the purpose or role of angels is because we see angels doing this quite often, and that's what the word means.
So you're not quite sure?
But yeah, frankly, we're not quite sure. Like, in terms of why did God actually create angels, which actually kind of goes into the second question of when did God actually create angels?
So, isn't also the belief that assume that one of the jobs of angels is to just worship God?
Yes, we see angels doing that quite often. So, and I think when we get into the facts and the actions, I put that in there to come up some. Let's talk about creation of angels first. Angels are created things, they are not self-existent things. So, getting a little bit ahead of myself, Satan, Christianity teaches, is a fallen angel. So an angel who rebelled against God, and so he is a created being. He is not co-equal with God. He is not some sort of equal opposite evilness to God's goodness. That's called dualism, and that's not Christian. So.
Happened supernatural. He had like a darkness sister person.
Yeah.
It was really, it was like the worst season too. So.
Not the worst season. It was one of the worst seasons.
Frankly, we don't exactly know when angels were created. Some suggested possibilities. Day 4. So if you turn to Genesis chapter 1, when we see the days of creation, verses 15 through 19 is day 4. If you need help finding Genesis, open the cover of your Bible, and you're in Genesis.
No, well, it's a table of contents.
No, this is something else. He just saves. God's plan, God's loving plan. Jesus Christ is alive today. Each one of those sections has.
So Genesis 1, 15.
Another book?
The next page is also stuff like that. The next page.
You're the wrong Bible. Is that the Message Bible?
This one's principles of translation. Then explanation of general format. Abbreviations and special markings.
Which are actually important sections of your Bible worth reading, by the way. The philosophy of translation, all that. Verse 15 of chapter 1 of Genesis. Actually, I'll start in 14. God said, "Let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years. And let them be lights in the expanse of the heavens to give light upon the earth. And it was so. And God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night and the stars. And God set them into the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God said that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning the fourth day." Now, I have a let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to separate. Does anybody have different words for those, that phrase, lights in the expanse of the heavens?
It just says he made the stars also.
The stars. Any other translations? One of the possible translations would be the luminaries. The light givers would be another legitimate translation. And in other places in the Bible, we see angels described as light bearers. So people are like, oh, okay, so
the angels are stars.
Yeah, this kind of like he created the stars and the angels at the same time.
It's wonderful why they have like the angels are the stars, and I thought that was what it was.
That's what it's like in Narnia.
Yeah.
Oh, the angels are stars. When they travel to the end of the world, they find a star.
And that's a fairly common ancient interpretation of this, is that angels were created on the fourth day with the stars. So y'all remember gap theory when we talked about creation views?
Yes.
Kinds of. What's gap theory?
Well, I just remember talking about it. Okay.
Is it like he created like
there's a gap between humans? There's a gap between creation of something.
Yeah, it's gap. So if you start at the very beginning, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth was without form and void. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters on the face of the earth. And the gap theory says then there's a huge gap of time, right? That thing, God creating the heavens and the earth being formless and void, was way, way back into ancient history. And the formless and voidness is chaos sort of thing. So creation occurred way, way back then. And verses 2b and onward, where God's making things, is him refashioning the earth that he created in much more ancient time. So
where is the biblical proof of that, or the biblical support?
The biblical support for it would be, one, the potential of answering some of these kinds of questions of when did angels fall? Well, they fell in the gap. They were created back at the beginning when God created the heavens and the earth, and then there's a whole history of earth that occurred before that isn't really recorded. The other linguistic support for that would be the difference in word between bara and asa. So you look at, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Created there is one Hebrew word. I don't remember if it's bara or asa, and I don't want to spend time looking it up right now. It's either bara or asa. It's created in verse 1. And then the rest of the time the word is created or made, the word created or made is used, it's a different word. It's the opposite. So, like, verse 7, "And God made the expanse and seated the waters above with the waters above." So God made the expanse. He made this. He made that. different word than for created in verse 1. So they'll say, since Moses used a different word, he's describing a different action. So they'll say, verse 1 and 2 is creation, actually bringing it into existence, then there's a gap of time, and then there's this refashioning that occurs in the 7 days. And the problem with gap, if I weren't a literal six-day creationist, I would be a gap theorist. I would take that view if I didn't hold to literal six-day creation. But the real problems with it are the lengths that people go with it. They're like, oh yeah, everything that they can't explain, they just throw it into the gap. Yeah, that occurred in the gap. Dinosaurs, that's in the gap.
Why would dinosaurs be?
Evolution, that's part of the gap. They get some really funky things that they just throw into the gap because...
They get funky.
Yeah, they can't explain. But that's one of the...
Nobody's ever seen
it. In the beginning. So when it says that God created the heavens and the earth. Heavens, heavenlies. These are common words used for angels, right? The heavenlies and the heavens all sang the praises of God. We see that all throughout the Psalms. And we're assuming that he's talking about the angels who are singing the praises of God, being the heavens. So, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The angels are part of the heavens that he created. So, between day 6 and 7, there's another option that people say. It's like, well, he rested on the day seven. He created Adam on day 6. So, and he didn't say when he created them. But obviously, angels are around by chapter 3 when Satan comes along. So... And he sets up two angels to guard the garden, so they must be there by then, so maybe it happened day 6 and 7. Those are the most common proposed answers of when were angels created.
You say at the beginning, does that sit, that mean like before like the light and stuff like that?
Yeah.
Or?
Before he created the earth, actually. So this is where, turn to Job 38. This is what a lot of angelology is, by the way. It's piecing together little verses that kind of reference some offshoot thing. You say, oh, maybe that helps to answer this question, but none of them are hard and fast. Obviously, this solves the problem kind of verses. But Job 38, you remember the book of Job? What's going on in chapter 38? Anybody remember?
Is that the part where he's talking to God? Asking why you're doing this to me, and God's like, hey, dude, I'm a boss.
Yeah, verse 30, like, chapter 38 is when God shows up. And he says one of my favorite verses in the Bible. Chapter 38, verse 2. Also, just a side note. If you read along while somebody's reading the Bible, you'll be more engaged and you'll learn something. Whereas I know that I tend to zone out when somebody's just reading the text, whereas if I'm reading it along with them, I'm actually thinking about what it says. Just as a side note, to how do you learn better? Not quite. So chapter 38 of Job, verse 1. And the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Stand up like a man. I will question you. You will make it known to me. Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Who stretched the line upon it, or what were its bases sunk, or who laid its cornerstone when the morning stars sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy? So when God is addressing Job, he talks about the morning stars and the sons of God shouting for joy at the earth's creation, which logically suggests that they were around when he created the earth. Right? So pre-creation of the earth would be a possible answer to the question of when did God create the angels, assuming that morning stars and sons of God are both names for angels.
Right? Well, doesn't Lucifer mean morning star?
Yes, it does. And morning star is also used to describe Jesus in Revelation.
I thought Lucifer meant light bearer.
Light bearer, morning star, light bringer.
Jerk.
Lucifer. They're all legitimate translations of.
Okay.
Zach, I think that's in the original text.
Oh. And then there was a jerk.
And he was the worst.
All that to say, we don't really know when creation went down. Early is my answer to that question. When were angels created? Early.
They were there pretty early,
yeah.
On.
So is the gap you're saying, it was specifically created in the gap, or they were created along with the heavens, and then they fell during the gap?
Either. Different. I mean, everybody answers this question a different way. So most gap theorists will say probably that they were created in the gap, and then their rebellion is what caused the formlessness and void. They'll say the rebellion of the angels is what caused the chaos of the earth that God is refashioning.
So, like, the earth was already there, and then the angels destroyed it, and then God recreated it?
Yeah, it's like they're saying Moses is just summarizing way, way back, God created the heavens and the earth. That happened. He's not telling you how that happened. And all of this history of earth back then happened, and he's not telling you anything about that.
And it's fullness of void.
And then verse 2, and God said, let there be light, and there was light, or verse 3. God said, let there be light, and there was light. That's him refashioning the earth and forming it into what we know it to be now.
That'd be kind of cool if that's how it was.
So I agree with, mostly with being created along with the heavens, because they're heavenly beings.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I don't think the gap applies. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think there's
which
a
that's
reason.
A legitimate view, I think.
I think there's a reason.
As legitimate as any of the others.
Just left that part out of the Bible. Like, you humans will...
They're going to be
way
too much.
Angels are actually when your dogs die, you just go up and become an angel.
That makes so much sense.
I don't know if you guys knew this. In lots of Renaissance painting, angels were depicted as Down syndrome people. So
really?
This is a particularly famous painting with two angels right there and right there who have Down syndrome. So those are zoomed in. Brothers are there. That was a common thing that they did. I don't really know exactly. I just know it's a historical tidbit. So, yeah.
Interesting.
Down's people were considered gifts from God or something like that. I don't know. Nature of angels. So, you're going to see a lot of texts thrown up here, the references, and those are for you to, next time you have the thought, hey, what about this? I can go look at this text. We're not going to read all of them, but give you a few main angel texts to chew on. Wholly different from humans, and they study humans. So turn to 1 Peter 1. I learned this and I was like, oh, that's kind of cool. So obviously, in some respects, angels are higher beings than humans. They're more powerful, strong. We see their strength displayed multiple places, like Sodom and Gomorrah. Angels burst the door open when tens of men are pressing in to try and rape Lot and the angels. But in other respects, they are beneath us. The Bible says that we will judge the angels. I think that's in Ephesians, so we might look at that too. But 1 Peter 1, verses 10 through 11... He's talking about the gospel. He's kind of laying it out. And he says, concerning this salvation, which you just got finished explaining, the salvation by grace through faith, the prophets who prophesied about the grace that was to be yours searched and inquired carefully, inquiring what persons or times the Spirit of Christ in them was indicating when he predicted the suffering of Christ and the subsequent glories. It was revealed to them that they were serving not themselves but you in the things that you have now announced to you through those who preach the good news to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things into which angels long to look. So this last line, things into which angels long to look. What are the things into which angels long to look? What did you just say?
The gospel.
The gospel, yeah. Humans get to experience salvation by grace through faith. And angels don't. They look on longingly at the grace that we've been displayed by God.
Quick question.
Yeah.
What about, I guess we don't know a lot, but what about demons? I mean...
We're going to talk about demons. We've got a whole slide, so...
Okay. Well, does it say stuff about the fact that we get grace and mercy and stuff, and they may or may not?
Yeah, we're going to look at a few of the passages that... to talk a little bit about that, or hint at it.
And then, quick question, this may be jumping ahead, but, like, does it, like, I know that people say, and that's kind of like a very well-known idea or belief, that angels don't have free will. Like,
yeah.
Where do they get that from?
from the idea that there are angels who will, who are permanently waiting damnation. So we'll look at some of the passages that indicate that. Good questions. Ephesians 3, which, by the way, I don't know if anybody was wondering, but I decided what we're going to study leading up to Riggins, and it'll be Galatians. And it's totally self-serving because my thesis is on Galatians and I start writing in the summer, so I'm getting a head start by teaching it to you.
Man, thanks, Jesus.
We're going through Galatians?
Yeah, leading up to Riggins.
I just got finished teaching Galatians to 7th graders.
Nice. Cool. You'll learn much more. I promise. 3:10-11. Oh, yeah. So that the church, this is in the midst of Paul talking about the mystery of the church being revealed. Again, the grace thing. So that through the church, the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. Who are the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places? Angels. So, essentially, the church, grace of the church is instructing angels in the character and nature of God. Which is kind of a crazy thing to think about, because they're actually in the presence of God in a more tangible sense than we are. So... and yet they learn something about God from his interactions with us. It's intriguing. There's various types or classes of angels. Two that are specifically mentioned in the Bible are cherubs and seraphs. You probably heard seraphim and cherubim. The im ending means plural in Hebrew. So, example would be Genesis 3:24. He placed two cherubs... or was it two cherubs or one cherub? I think it was two cherubs because it says cherubim. Outside the garden to keep Adam and Eve from coming back. He drove out the man, and at the east of the Garden of Eden, he placed the cherubim and a flaming sword that turned every way to guard the way to the tree of life. So when you see cherubim and seraphim, those are what's called transliterations. It means... they just took the sounds of the Hebrew words and put them into English letters, because we don't really know exactly what they mean in English. We don't have an English equivalent, so we just take the sounds and we say, oh yeah, okay, we'll make those into English letters. So if you were to read that in Hebrew, it would say something along the lines of words you don't understand, and then you hear the word cherubim, because it's the same word. Probably a type of angel is what we gather. Same with... turn to Isaiah 6. This is one of the clearest descriptions of a physical angel appearing that we see.
That's the choose me part, right? Like, I am here, choose me.
Yes. Right before that, he gets a vision of two seraphim. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1. So read along with me. In Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." The foundations of the thresholds shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, for I am lost. For I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth and said, "Behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for." This is one of the first types of type, meaning like foreshadowing sort of thing. Of atonement, removal of sin by grace. So it's the angel just comes up and does it. Right? And this is Isaiah, the prophet, seeing this vision. But in this vision is two seraphim, and this is one particular artist rendition of the seraphim with six wings, right? Two he's covering his feet, two he flew, and two he covered his, what is it, his head, his face? people have speculated all kinds of things about what the six wings represent, why he's covering his feet and his head, and what all of these mean, and I don't put a whole lot of stock in any of them. All I know is that it happened.
The way it says in mine, it says, each having six wings, it says with two he covered his face, with two he covered his feet, with two he flew.
Yeah.
So it makes it between plural and singular. Is that just...
That's just Hebrew.
Okay.
That's just it's because it's weird. But what it's saying is each one had six wings, two of them each one flew. Just because Hebrew is hard to translate, so they do the best they can. Idea of archangels. Have you all heard of that?
Yes.
That there are archangels who are above the other angels, and
Michael, Gabriel, specific ones, right?
People suggest that Michael is an archangel. I think it actually might actually say somewhere in the Bible that Michael is an archangel.
Because you gave me those angel books,
yeah,
and it said that there were like four of them. So Michael, I think Gabriel was one of them, but that was like debatable for certain people.
Yeah,
and two names I can't remember.
Yeah, and Raphael is another one. In Catholic doctrine, there's seven archangels, one for each day of the week.
Conveniently.
Yeah, some people will say that there's three archangels, and they'll get that from Revelation 12. We're going to come back to Revelation 12 a little bit, but that's when the dragon, Satan, sweeps away a third of the stars. So people, like C.S. Lewis, put forward the idea that maybe Satan was an archangel, so he had control of a third of the angels, and then Michael and Gabriel were the other two archangels, and so that's why a third of the angels went. Again, this is in the midst of a metaphor, so...
There's not a ton of solid translation that can be done.
Yeah, it's interesting theory. I definitely am not going to stake my reputation on it, but as good a guess as any. What about the angel of the Lord? So we talked a little bit about this when we did bibliology and Christology and theology proper. But Exodus 3:2, what's going on in Exodus chapter 3? Think about the book of Exodus for a second and say, okay.
Who is that, when the angel of death?
Good guess, but no, that'd be later in Exodus.
That would be when Moses was... That'd be like... Is that close to the burning bush?
There you go, burning bush. That's wrong. Exodus 1 is birth of Moses. Exodus 2 is Moses fleeing. Exodus 3 is burning bush. Exodus 3:2, it actually says the angel of the Lord is the one that's in the bush. And then the angel of the Lord identifies himself as Yahweh, right? Reveals his covenant name to Moses at this time. That's Exodus 3, verse 2. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. He looked and behold, the bush was burning, but it was not consumed. And so... there's a lot of theorizing that the angel of the Lord is the pre-incarnate Christ, meaning the second person of the Trinity, Jesus. Before he had human flesh, he showed up in this form, the angel of the Lord. So he shows up quite a bit. I gave you many references where he shows up. Judges 2, 1 through 4, look at that one. Joshua, Judges, Ruth. Okay, Judges 2. 1 through 4. This is right after Moses dies, right? Wandering in the wilderness. They've just finished wandering. They're about to go in. Or they've already taken the nation. That's Joshua. And so this is right after Joshua dies, excuse me. And so they're going, okay, well, Joshua's dead. What are we going to do now? That's right before he dies, excuse me. Chapter 2, verse 1. Now the angel of the Lord went up from Gilgal to Bochim. And he said, I brought you up from Egypt and brought you into the land that I swore to give to your fathers. I said, I will never break my covenant with you, and you shall make no covenant with the inhabitants of this land. You shall break down their altars, but you have not obeyed my voice. What is this you have done? So now I say, I will not drive them out before you, but they shall become thorns in your side, and their gods shall be a snare to you. As soon as the angel of the Lord spoke these words to all the people of Israel, people lifted up their voices and wept, and they called the name of the place Bochim, which means weepers, and they sacrificed there to the Lord. Then Joshua dies. So the angel of the Lord appears, and he claims that he promised to give them this land. Who is the one who promised to give them this land? Yeah, Yahweh, back with Abraham and with Jacob, and with Moses and with Joshua. So there's strong evidence in favor of the idea that the angel of the Lord is, if not the second person of the Trinity, a representative of the Godhead in some form.
Kind of like the mouth of Sauron.
Sure. We'll go with that. there's also Zechariah chapter 3. I think he seems to talk about atoning for sins, which sounds very much like something the second person of the Trinity would do. The other thing, though, is that it never actually says that it's God, right? It says the angel of the Lord. So might this be a type of angel that we just don't really have a category for? One of the other big arguments for why this is the angel, this is God, is because we see the angel of the Lord accepting worship in certain places. Somebody will bow down and worship the angel of the Lord, and it's all cool. But in other places, we see somebody bow down to worship an angel, and they say, don't do that, get up. I'm not God, don't worship me, worship God. So, make your own conclusions. I'm not convinced one way or the other on the angel of the Lord.
If it is an angel, would that mean that angels have the power to curse people?
Good question. Seeing this, we're like a whole other thing that I might bring up later. If we don't get there, I'll bring it up. I don't know. I think that maybe if the angel of the Lord is not one of the members of the Godhead, then yes, certain angels do have the power to curse people. But at the same time, that really doesn't gel with my theology that says only God can bless and curse. So, I don't know. Like I said, the main thing I walked out of my angelology class was, yeah, we really don't know.
So, hasn't it said in the Bible, an angel of the Lord, not the angel of the Lord?
Yeah, so there are plenty of places where the definite article is not used, where it will say, ha-malak, the angel, versus malak, an angel. We supply the an ourselves. I think those are more, this is going to sound elitist and I don't mean it to be, but those are more arguments that people who don't read Hebrew make. Your English Bible will say the angel of the Lord or an angel of the Lord, and you read into that a lot. The article isn't as definite in Hebrew or Greek like it is in English. The word and the word the are very interchangeable a lot of the time in both Hebrew and Greek. So. But yet, that argument is out there. And there are people who know the original languages who still make it. So, I wouldn't say it's completely irrelevant. I just don't think it's that great of a thing. Here are the facts that I know about angels. First of all, angels are created by Christ. Colossians 1:16 clearly says, through him all things were made. That includes angels, because angels are things that got made at one point. So they were created, and they were created by Christ. They do not marry or divorce. That's something that Jesus says about angels in Matthew. Turn to Matthew 22. This is an interesting one. Again, it's just like a whole lot of this stuff is just like throwaway lines that somebody will say at the end, just like the angels do. Okay, well, hold on. What do you mean, just like the angels do? That's 1 Corinthians 11, I'm getting... Right, but we're looking at Matthew 22.
No. First of all, no.
This is when he's talking about... you guys know the story, the Sadducees come up and they're like, if a man dies without having children with his wife, she goes and marries his brother, he dies without children, and whose wife is he in the resurrection? Right? And they don't even believe in the resurrection, so it's this big... ironic thing that the Sadducees are the one asking in this. He answers the question, you're idiots. is essentially, I'm paraphrasing, but that's essentially what he said. Verse 29, Jesus answered them, "You are wrong, because you know neither the scriptures nor the power of God. For in the resurrection they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are like the angels in heaven. And as for the resurrection of the dead," they're like, wait, what do you mean they're like the angels of heaven? They neither marry nor given in marriage. Where is that? But yeah, so, but Jesus said it, and he pretty clearly, that's the point he's making. They don't marry or are given in marriage. Marriage isn't a thing, like it isn't a thing with the angels.
So would that mean, on a bigger general scale, that they don't have emotions? Or, I mean, marriage has to do with love, right? And so, it's kind of like, you can't love.
We could get into a huge tangent, but love doesn't have to do with emotions either, so.
Well, I mean, fair enough, but I'm just saying, like,
I would definitely say that angels experience emotion, because we see them quarreling at times, and we see Satan getting angry and being cooled. We see them war, which is hard to have war without some sort of emotion accompanying it. But again, those are guesses. Confident that some of them rebelled. So this is one of the things that we're confident about. God created all these angels and some of them rebelled. So turn to Matthew 25. This is still Jesus talking. Okay, go. Yeah. Bye-bye. 15 minutes.
What time did you have to leave? We have to go in 15 minutes, unless someone wants to take you.
And I can't today, actually.
Okay, we may have to go soon.
Bummer.
Huh?
I don't know if we can take you. I'll go to church. I don't know what's on.
I have a math test tomorrow. We will see.
You don't want to skip around to something in particular, then? Is there anything on this paper where you're like, okay, I want to cover that? Or y'all just have questions that you want to jump to? It's like, I've always heard this about angels. Let's get to that.
I do have one question.
Yeah.
My mom has said before that there are no female angels, which I kind of believe too, because that's not really mentioned in the Bible.
Usually those arguments will because, yeah, there's no female angels who appear, or there's no angels who appear in the form of women. Genesis 6, the fallen angels, which we can look at that, where the sons of God, if you think those are angels, come down and procreate with the daughters of men. So people will look at that, they'll look at the fact that angels do not marry or not given in marriage, and the fact that no female angels appear, and they'll say, then there must not be any female angels. Again, that's one of those things, pretty good guess based on what we have, but I wouldn't stake my life on it.
Where in the Bible does it specifically talk about Satan's rebellion?
Yeah, so let's go to Satanology. Can't see that picture very well. Satan from the Passion. Satan, as you've known if you've heard me rant at all, is just a word that means adversary or enemy. Not the closest thing we have to a proper name, but we don't really know what his proper name is. We're sure it's not Lucifer. So, happy to burst that bubble for you. Where in the Bible we hear about his rebellion? Two prophetic passages. Isaiah 14. You're going to want to turn there, by the way. You're going to want to read it for yourself, because it's a little confusing. So these are prophecies that the respective prophets, Isaiah and Ezekiel, are giving to different kings. So Isaiah 14, start at the beginning of the chapter. Read along with me. "For the Lord will have compassion on Jacob, and will again choose Israel, and will set them in their own land. And sojourners will join them with and will attach themselves to the house of Jacob, and people will take them and bring them to their place, and the house of Israel will possess them in the Lord's land as male and female slaves. They will take captive those who were their captors and rule over those who oppressed them. When the Lord has given you the rest from your pain and turmoil and the hard service with which you were made to serve, you will take up this taunt against the king of Babylon." Okay, who is Isaiah going to take up a taunt against?
King of Babylon.
The king of Babylon. That's what the text says. Okay. He starts this taunt. How the oppressor has ceased, the insolent fury ceased, the Lord has broken the staff of the wicked, the scepter of the rulers has struck the peoples in wrath with unceasing blows. So this, after God has conquered the Babylonians, putting you back over, then you're going to taunt them with this. That's what he's saying. The taunt goes on and on, and he gets to verse 12, or start in verse 10. All of them will answer and say to you, you too have become as weak as we and have become like us. Verse 11. Your pomp is brought down to Sheol, ancient word for the grave. The sound of your harps, maggots are laid as a bed beneath you, and worms are your covers. How you have fallen from heaven, O day star, son of dawn. That's where the word Lucifer comes from, by the way. O day star, some of you might have morning star, might have Lucifer. It's a Latin translation of the word in the Hebrew that means day star or morning star. How you are cut down to the ground, you who laid the nations low. You said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven above the stars of God. I will set my throne on high. I will sit on the mount of assembly in the far reaches of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. But you are brought down to Sheol, to the far reaches of the pit. Those who see you will stare at you and ponder over you. So this section seems like he's not talking to an earthly king, the king of Babylon anymore. He talks about the things that he's done. He calls him the fallen from heaven, morning star, day star. Talks about how you said in your heart that you would ascend to heaven above the stars of God. That doesn't sound like something that an earthly king normally does. I will set my throne on high. I will sit in the mount of assembly in the far reaches of the north, etc. So this is often a passage that people point to that talk about the fall of Satan. My problem is, at the very beginning of this, he says you're going to take up your taunt against who?
The king of Babylon.
King of Babylon. That's who he's talking to. So the usual interpretation will be he's talking to the king of Babylon, but also to the demonic force, Satan, behind the king of Babylon. He's saying that they'll say Satan is possessed or influenced this king, and so the taunt is going to the king of Babylon and to Satan. And they'll say this language seems to be talking about something beyond it. However, I think that all of this in Isaiah 14 could easily be interpreted as hyperbole speaking about a human earthly king. So I don't think Isaiah 14 is talking about Satan or his fall. I think he's talking about an earthly king, king of Babylon, who said in his heart, I'm going to be greater than God, like a whole lot of people do. It's kind of how sin works. So I don't think Isaiah 14 is talking about Satan. Great godly people all throughout church history who do interpret it that way, and more power to them as long as they're clear and they understand why they're claiming that from the text.
But what does it mean when it says how you have fallen from heaven?
I would say that how you've descended from your place, from your high place. How you were in charge, you were Almighty King, and now Israel's ruling over you. So okay. We're taunting him.
Okay.
I do think Ezekiel 28 is talking about Satan. So turn to that one. Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, James. Isaiah, Ezekiel 28, verses 1 through 15. So this is Ezekiel writing, obviously, because it's the book of Ezekiel. And he said in verse 1 of chapter 28, the word of the Lord came to me, son of man, say to the prince of Tyre, thus says the Lord God. Okay, who's he saying this to? Prince of Tyre. Tyre is an old ancient nation from around the Philistine area. Ancient city. Say to the prince of Tyre, because your heart is proud, and you have said, I am a god, I sit in the seat of the gods, in the heart of the seas, yet you are but a man and no god. Though you make your heart like the heart of a god, you are indeed wiser than Daniel. No secret is hidden from you. By your wisdom and your understanding, you have made wealth for yourself, and you have gathered gold and silver into your treasuries. By your great wisdom in your trade, you have increased your wealth, and your heart has become proud in your wealth. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, because you make your heart like the heart of a god, therefore, behold, I will bring foreigners upon you, the most ruthless of all the nations. They shall draw their swords against you and defile you and your splendor. So what's he saying to the king of Tyre? Somebody summarize it for me.
They'll bring him down.
He'll bring you down, and why?
Because
Yeah, because you've been so proud. Verse 11. Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me, Son of man, raise a lamentation over the king of Tyre, and say to him, Thus says the Lord God. So who is he talking to now?
King of Tyre.
King of Tyre, as opposed to Prince of Tyre in the first half. You were the signet of perfection. This is verse 12. End of verse 12. You were the signet of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering. Sardius, topaz, and diamond, beryl, onyx, jasper, sapphire, emerald, garment. Crafted in gold were you sitting, your sitting settings and your engravings. On the day that you were created, they were prepared. You were an anointed guardian cherub. I placed you. You were on the holy mountain of God. In the midst of the stones of fire you walked. You were blameless in your ways from the day you were created until unrighteousness was found in you and the abundance of your trade. You were filled with violence in your midst, and you sinned. So I cast you as a profane thing from the mountain of God, and I destroyed you, O guardian cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire. Your heart was proud because of your beauty. You corrupted your wisdom for the sake of your splendor. I cast you to the ground. I exposed you before kings to feast their eyes on you. So there's a few things in here that make me think, okay, I don't know if he's talking to the king of Tyre anymore, because he was just talking to the prince of Tyre, but things like, you were in Eden, and that's a pretty clear reference back to Genesis chapters 2 and 3. The king of Tyre definitely wasn't in Eden. He calls him a guardian cherub, which again might be hyperbole, like you were a mighty angelic being, but might be more literal than that. I placed you, you're on the holy mountain of God. That's the thing, it was like, that sure seems to be talking about something not earthly.
So what's the, I guess it'd be Hebrew, right, of like, the king of Tyre?
I could guess, but I could also just look it up and read it, so let me do that. Short version is, I think that Ezekiel 28, there's a good reason to suggest that the second half of Ezekiel 28 is talking about Satan, the enemy, the accuser. I do not think Isaiah 14 is clear enough for me to say, yeah, it's talking about Satan. So, so the question of why did Satan fall? I do think that it's okay to say it's because of pride in his beauty, because that's what verse 17 of Ezekiel 28 says. And since I think Ezekiel 28 is talking about Satan, fair enough. But I don't think his name was Lucifer, because, first of all, because it wasn't, but also because I don't. Even if Isaiah 14 is talking about him, his name wasn't Lucifer. That was just a description, O morning star. That gets used in plenty of other places.
In there it says, on the day you were created, they were prepared. And so if it is talking about Satan, and the heavens and the earth are created at the same time, it's more, it's pointing to the created with the heavens.
Yeah, and the day that they were created, they being the stones that he just listed, right? Yeah, I agree. So let's see, what is the difference? You can give me a run for my money, because I don't know Hebrew anywhere near as well as I do Greek, so give me a minute. Say to the leader of Tyre, Li Nagid. So Li Nagid, Nagid would be the leader.
So it's not necessarily king, but leader.
No, leader. That would be the first one. That'd be the prince. That some translate prince would be the Nagid. King would be probably Malak. Let me make sure. Over the king of Tyre, verse 12. Melech, yeah. Kina Amelech, yeah. So king means king. That's the word for king.
Okay.
The first one, Prince of Tyre, is Nagid. So leader, prince, something slightly lower than king. Melech is a pretty common word. It gets used in a lot of different ways. So, the where he's headed part of Satan is pretty clear. Multiple places all throughout Scripture. Matthew 25:41 is where Jesus specifically says, and this is something I wanted to make clear. Hell is not some realm that Satan is in charge of. That's common cultural perceptions of Satan and hell. But hell is a punishment for Satan and his demons. And they don't want to go there. They don't like it any more than the humans who will be going there. 25:41 Then he will say to those on his left, "Depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels." The enemy and his messengers. Another completely legitimate translation of that phrase. But, and then Revelation 19:20, obviously, when we see the lake of fire, the beast, the false prophet, get cast into the lake of fire, and then Satan leads an uprising. God ends it with a breath, and he casts Satan into the lake of fire.
So my history teacher, earlier this week, I think, he said that it doesn't actually mention hell specifically anywhere in the Bible. No one does talk about hell. It's just the Hebrew, for like lake of fire. He said it's like a desert, kind of. So it's just, you know, a bunch of people like sitting around the desert. And that sounded way off to me.
Yeah, that's... So there's three words that get translated sometimes hell. Or get understood as hell in the Bible. There's Hades, which linked with the obviously mythical god Hades, ruler of the underworld sort of thing. There's Gehenna, which is the garbage valley outside of Jerusalem where they would burn their trash, maggots would be living. So quite often when Jesus is talking about hell, he uses the word Gehenna. Valley of Hinnom is what that Gehenna. Gehenom. Valley of Hinnom is this place where they would burn the trash. And Jesus is very clearly using Gehenna as an example. This is what it's going to be like in the ultimate resting place, which is the lake of fire, which is Revelation. Lake of fire, I think, only shows up in Revelation. And let me look at what the actual phrase is, and then I can tell you if there's any legitimacy to... I've never heard that before.
Yeah, he says some things that, like... They sound right, but at the same time, they sound super off. Like for Christmas, he said that it's technically against the Bible because you know, so don't put lights on your trees. Like he specifically said that. But when you look it up, it's just like don't worship an idol. An example being, you know, putting lights on the tree and worshiping it.
Yeah.
So we have to go.
Verse 20. Of chapter 19. Cast these alive, the two of them, into Talimnain Tupuras, which means lake of fire. Limnain, lake. Puras, fire. Not a whole lot of variance.
Goodbye.
So long.
Goodbye, goodbye, goodbye.
Anything y'all have wondered about angels, demons? We're dwindling in numbers.
Yeah, we are.
My grandma said once that she heard on a podcast that somebody said that like, when it's really windy out, it's like a lot of angels doing their thing.
I don't know where that would come from.
Yeah.
There might be some offhand reference in one of the Gospels that says something about the angels. The only thing that comes to mind is the legend of the pool at Bethesda, right? The guy who's waiting for the angel to stir up the water so they can get in and be healed. But even that is a legend, not It's not like Jesus saying, this is what's actually happening. It's just, that's what everybody believed was happening. Possibly Balaam, when he... Balaam, when he sees the angel in front of the donkey. And I forget who it is that God reveals to them so they can see the multitude of angels who are at war on the hill. Remember what I'm talking about at all? Let's Google it. Yeah. I wouldn't think there's much weight behind it either. Elisha, 2 Kings 6:17. Excuse me. Then Elisha prayed and said, O Lord, please open his eyes that he may see. So the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. And when the Syrians came down against him, Elisha prayed, and the Lord said, please strike these people with blindness. So he struck them with blindness in accordance with the prayer of Elisha. Elisha said to them, this is not the way, this is not the city. Follow me, and I will bring you the man to whom you seek. Lead them to Samaria. So we have this, like, all of a sudden, this kid can see this big battle that's going on around him that he couldn't before. So, thinking probably heavenly angels sort of thing. We pair that up with Daniel 10, which I think is in the... Yeah, Daniel 10, 13. We see angels at war quite a bit in different places. And this is one of them. One of the weirdest little things that we see. Daniel 10's a funky chapter. He has this crazy vision of a man standing on the bank of a river. And he kind of like passes out after receiving this vision. Start in verse 10. And behold, a hand touched me and set me trembling on my hands and knees. And he said to me, O Daniel, man greatly loved, understand the word that I speak to you and stand upright, for now I have been sent to you. And when he had spoken this word to me, I stood up trembling. And he said to me, fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that you set your heart to understand and humbled yourself before your God, your words have been heard, and I have come because of your words. The prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days, but Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, for I was left there with the kings of Persia, and came to make you understand what is to happen to your people in the latter days, for the vision is for the days yet to come. It's clear from earlier context that this is an angel who's talking. And he says, yeah, King of Persia was holding me up. Michael came, helped me out, let me go. It's like, okay. I don't really know what to do with that. Revelation 12 is another big angel passage. That's the vision of the woman and the dragon. Y'all remember Revelation?
Vaguely.
So well. What was that, 2 years ago now?
Wow, that was a long time.
And a great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and with the moon under her feet, and on her head a crown of 12 stars. She was pregnant and was crying out in birth pains and agony of birth giving. And another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, a great red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns, and on his head 7 diadems. His tail swept down a third of the stars of heaven and cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman who was about to give birth, so that when she bore her child, he might devour it. She gave birth to a male child, one who is to rule all the nations with a rod of iron, but her child was caught up with God in his throne. Let's get down to verse 7. Now a war arose in heaven. Michael and his angels fighting against the dragon. And the dragon and his angels fought back. But he was defeated, and there was no longer any place for them in heaven. And the great dragon was thrown down, that ancient serpent, who is called the devil and Satan, the deceiver of the whole world. He was thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. Okay, so there we get this clear description of some sort of war going on between Michael and the devil, and Michael's angels and the devil's angels. And he clearly says, this is the verse, by the way, this, and then he says the same thing in verse 20, in chapter 20. This is the verse that clarifies the serpent is the devil, is Satan, all the same person. That's how we don't know that the serpent is the guy who is deceiving Jesus in the wilderness until Revelation. There's no necessarily clear verse that proves it. Yeah.
So that means like there's literally like wars going on around us that we just don't see.
Yeah.
That's a cool thought.
Yeah, heavenly wars. And this plays into what Paul talks about. We war not with flesh and blood, but with principalities, powers of the air, right? The angels, the demons. There's spiritual war going on that we are unaware of. Again, contributing to my final conclusion of, I just don't know. There's all this stuff that they just say. Obviously, this is true about angels. Okay. Well, we'll go with that.
So, on the topic of, the spiritual wars.
Yeah.
Does that necessarily mean that angels can be, killed or...
Interesting thought. Don't know. We know that they will be cast into the lake of fire. Probably not. Because Jesus says that the lake of fire was prepared for them so that they would be cast there. So it would seem to suggest that they couldn't die before going there. Or if they can be killed, then they also experience some sort of resurrection, some sort of eternal life that is life in torment in the lake of fire. They're fighting, but yeah, is it just some sort of eternal battle where they're like the two Hulks going at each other? And they can't actually kill each other. Don't know. There are places where we see. So 1 Peter 3. So we already look at that one. I think we looked at 1 Peter 1. First Peter 3:17-20. For it is better to suffer for doing good than if that should be God's will than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sins, and the righteousness for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. In the spirit in which he went and proclaimed to the spirits in prison, because they formerly did not obey when God's patience waited in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is 8 persons, were brought safely to the waters. Who are these spirits that he's going to proclaim to? Well, the same spirits probably that Jude is talking about in verses 6 and 7. So you go to Jude, verse 6. There's only one chapter in Jude. And the angels, who did not stay within their own position of authority, but left their proper dwelling, he has kept in eternal chains under gloomy darkness until the judgment of the great day, just as Sodom and Gomorrah and the surrounding cities, which likewise indulged in sexual immorality and pursued unnatural desires, serve as an example by undergoing a punishment of eternal fire. So there's some angels that did something for which they're being kept in eternal chains until the judgment of the great day, and they will undergo the punishment of eternal fire. Most people will say this is referring to Genesis 6. So if you turn to Genesis 6, that's why I have all three of these up there. Genesis 6, verse 1. When man began to multiply on the face of the land, so this, by the way, so Genesis she should know the first few chapters of Genesis. Just you should know what goes on. Chapter 1, 7 days of creation. Chapter 2, specific view of Adam and Eve's creation. Chapter 3, anybody? Genesis chapter 3.
The fall.
Chapter 4.
Cain and
Abel. Chapter 5. That one is a little bit tougher. You go look at the heading of chapter 5.
Is that the lineage of Adam?
Yes. Genealogy of Adam and his sons, all the way to Noah. Chapter 6 starts after that. After Noah was 500 years old, Noah fathered Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Chapter 6. Now when man began to multiply on the face of the land, the daughters were born to them, and the sons of God saw the daughters of man were attractive. And they took as their wives any they chose. Then the Lord said, My spirit shall not abide in man forever, for he is flesh. His days shall be 120 years. The Nephilim, again, Hebrew transliterated word because we don't know exactly what it means, were on the earth in those days, and also afterward, when the sons of God came into the daughters of man, and they bore children to them. These were the mighty men who were of old, the men of renown. So, who were these sons of God who came down and saw that the daughters of men were attractive and took them as their wives, any that they chose? Most people will say sons of God means angels. They'll look at Job, when Job 38 that we looked at earlier, the sons of God were rejoicing over the creation of the earth. Say, okay, sons of God means angels. That is a very prominent view that's called the angel view. That sons of God were angels who took on human forms, came down, and procreated with human women. That's also written about in the book of Enoch, an apocryphal book, right? Not inspired scripture, but an ancient text. And it actually describes this whole story where the lead demon, Azazel, comes down and finds the women and procreates with them. Interesting story. Worth reading. You can find it online. Just Google Book of Enoch. But it also, in that thing, talks about the angels, the Nephilim being like 120 stories tall. And stuff like that. It's like, none of that's in the actual text of scripture, so what do you do with that?
Speaking of 120, is this referring to all men living to be 120?
It's saying that 120 days from when God said that, he was going to flood them. The Lord said, My spirit shall not abide with man forever, for he is flesh. His days shall be 120 years. As in, he's got 120 years left before I wipe them all out.
Okay. So is there anywhere in the Bible that says they're going to live to 120?
Yeah. That's where most people are just misunderstanding the intent of that verse. The other question is, what are the Nephilim? Most people will suggest that it means giants. So they'll talk about some sort of giants that were on the earth at that time that were half angel, half human procreants of these rebellious angels who came down and made whoopee with the women.
Were the rebellious angels demons, or were they different?
Yeah, so they're definitely, we call them demons, assuming that these are angels. So that's the first view that says angels came down, literally took on human form, literally made babies with human women. Two other views, the Seth line view, which I lean to now. I used to lean toward the third view, I'll tell you, but the idea that sons of God is talking about those descendant that are according to the godly lineage that is expecting the Messiah. So the sons of God and then the daughters of men would be the ungodly lineage that's descendant from mostly Cain. And so they're intermingling and essentially thwarting the lineage of the Messiah. And I would say that it's probably demonically motivated, that it's sons of men, these descendants from Cain, are being motivated by demons in order to thwart the coming of the Messiah, the seed from Genesis 3:15. That's what this whole thing is about, looking for that guy. With that context in mind, I think it actually makes a whole lot of sense to read it that way. But, and then that would explain Jude and 1 Peter, because we're saying, yes, there were demons that were behind that action, and they are the ones that Jude is talking about who are being kept in prison. Those are the spirits that 1 Peter is talking about that Jesus went down and proclaimed to victory over. So this particular group of demons who were causing that thing to happen are being kept in eternal chains waiting for the lake of fire. There are other demons that we would say are free and tempting and doing things to people, as we see all throughout the Gospels, right? But the third view is the despot's view. It just means that the sons of God refers to the kind of the rulers, the princes of the age who are in charge of things, and the daughters of men refer to more like the peasants, the less powerful people, and they're going and pillaging and plundering and taking all the women that they want, and God sees this and is displeased. And again, they'll say either it was demonically motivated or it wasn't, depending on how they explain that view. You can read all about these three views and why I used to take the despot's view and used to be very derogatory toward the Seth Lyne view. Just shows you how your interpretation can change the more you study. On my blog, I think I still have that post somewhere in there. Yeah, who were the sons of God? So I just sit there and I go through and I detail it. So the angel view, Seth Lyne view, and sociology view, or kings and despots view. And I go through each view and then analyze the views. But back then when I wrote that, I landed on the sociology view, or the with a bent toward the angel view, and now I take the Seth Lyne view. So I have no idea what the Nephilim are. Nobody does. That's why they have to transliterate it instead of translate it. They have to leave it in Hebrew. That's one of the big, like, demon passages. What's going on in chapter 6 of Genesis? Don't know. How are we doing on time? We got 10 minutes. Any other angel questions? Anything you see on here that make you go, what do you mean by that?
Why do you have can take human forms and take human form question mark? Those two different things.
Because I wasn't really thinking. Because when I was creating this, I was originally going to do different things. So I had half of a slide set up, and then I changed the way I was going to organize it and change it to perceived actions. So probably the take human forms thing would be, with the question mark, would be the one that I legitimize, and I would erase the can take human forms.
Right, so why is there a question mark after Satan? Because Satan definitely said in one of the...
So yeah, this is the question of can angels still sin? So I would say definitely during the rebellion of the angels, however that went down, as described in Ezekiel 28, Satan fell because of his pride. He viewed himself as more beautiful than he was and tried to thwart God, essentially. He took some of his angels with him, according to Revelation 12. They had a war with Michael, again, according to Revelation 12, and they took possession of the earth. Again, that's all Revelation 12. The question, though, is can angels still do that? Right? Satan did it once with a group of angels. Can they still? Most people will say no. The eternal destinations of angels are now locked in. And the main reason would be because we never see them doing it again after Genesis 6. Right? Genesis 6 is the only time where, if you take the angel view, that you actually see angels rebelling and doing something. And it seems from Jude and First Peter, those verses that we had up for the demons, that God permanently put an end to that, right? He put them in chains. Christ went down and proclaimed something to them. So, again, this is a guess, but I think it's a pretty strong guess that angels no longer have the ability to rebel or not rebel. They're stuck in the positions that they've chosen. Those who followed Satan will follow Satan all the way to the lake of fire. As Jesus says in Matthew 25, the lake of fire that is prepared for the devil and his angels. And those who did not choose to follow Satan will not choose, and they cannot anymore, and that ability has been taken away from them by God.
The will not part makes sense, but in context, so it says angels like will prolong, you think?
Yeah.
Because, you know, they're like, oh, if I follow Satan, I'm going to go to the lake of fire, so I can't do that.
Yeah. It's like they look on the grace that we have questioningly, right? They don't understand it because they have a different nature than we do. We have some sort of nature that allows us to rebel and be in God's favor at the same time, and they don't have that. Again, those are all guesses. Those are putting pieces together. You see how many passages I had to jump around to kind of get there, right? There's no just like, it's not like a book that just explains angels inside the Bible. That would be so great if there was.
I wonder why nobody thought to do that. But nobody, you mean God. Because
there's also a few things that I kind of wanted to prepare you guys for. Moving forward in history, the way we're headed, there are some things that are going to become a lot more popular in the church. One is to deny the existence of angels and demons. I think that's very bad. And most of it will be dancing around, well, you see, in ancient times, demons were just their simple minds not able to comprehend what sicknesses were. And so what they perceived as demon possession was actually just physical ailments. We have cures for that. We don't need to have this sort of childish belief in angels and demons anymore. Also, one that I believe is going to get a lot more steam soon is the idea that Satan isn't a personal being. He is a force, some sort of... They'll say, oh, we see ancient Jews and first century Jews actually viewed the enemy as this more of non-personal force, this darkness that sort of invades someone. And it's not like a personal creature that God created. It's not some spiritual being that has a personality. And that just goes against so many texts. And each one of those will dance around inside of them. They'll be like, oh, well, you're just like, I'm sorry. You sit down and you read the temptations of Jesus, where Satan says something and Jesus says something back. This isn't some sort of a non-personal dark force. This is some being who is trying to do some particular thing. He has a will. He's trying to accomplish something. Namely, he's trying to thwart the Messiah in his goal. And I see that coming in the church. There's guys who are scholars who are really propagating that big time now. And it's going to trickle down into the church in the next 10, 15 years. So I would encourage you to think through those ideas and then read the text carefully and be sure of where you can turn to and say, that's obviously wrong. Like, how can you read this as this being a personal force or a non-personal force? And doing that work ahead of time so that when it shows up, we're not caught off guard. But personal pet peeve. So I listed some of the places where it seems to be obvious that Satan is a personal being. These are also the guys who say that we don't have to believe in a historical Adam. If Adam and Eve weren't literal historical people, it doesn't really matter that much. They'll talk about how they're archetypal humans, and that genetics has clearly proven that all the humans who exist on Earth couldn't have come from just two people. So obviously Adam and Eve couldn't have existed. If you deny the historical Adam, you have huge, huge problems with all the rest of your Christianity. Because Christianity is based off of the idea that all are sinners by nature because of the sin of Adam, and all have inherited that state and need to be saved from it by grace through faith. if that state isn't there, the need for salvation is no longer there, and so the need for a savior is no longer there, and so we can have Christianity without Christ. Doesn't work. Yeah. And those sorts of things are coming. They're just down the road, and they're going to be so much more common in a more conscious way. They're already common in that people don't really actually internalize these beliefs. They say they believe them, but they don't really think through, yes, I actually believe there was a man and a woman who talked to a snake in a garden at least 6,000 years ago, if not a little bit more. I think that literally happened on Earth. And it sounds kind of crazy. And it should, because it's a little bit crazy, unless it's true, unless it actually happened. And I believe that it does. I have good reason to believe that it did. So, anyway, it's people who are really trying to make the faith palatable to people, and in so doing, they destroy what Christianity is. And they destroy themselves, because they're the major losers in that equation. Because guess what? Just because we change our faith doesn't change the way God has set up the situation. So, sorry, I'm rambling now. Things to be ready for. Jerry's having a good time. Anyway, so that's angelology. We will not meet next week because it's Easter. You all want to be with family and stuff at Easter. So, 2 weeks, we'll do eschatology.